paper will actually focus us on the Terramara settlement of Montale in northern Italy, and where I think there is really striking evidence of war textile production at industrial scale, I would like to say. The site of Montale is a Terramara site. It's a Middle Bronze Age Italian Middle Bronze Age settlement. As you can see here, it starts around 1550 and it gets abandoned probably around 1200 BC. It is a very dynamic, the whole Terramara phenomenon, we'll have another slide, it's a very dynamic phenomenon, and one of the, maybe the signs that this is, these communities are continually changing and developing, and in a way adjusting to probably the environment around them, is the architecture, as you can see here in this reconstruction, during the first phases of the Terramara phenomenon, you will have a pile dwelling, and then in the, which disappears and they become normal houses in later period. And since archaeologists are more or less agree that it's a sort of colonization of the plain where they are, and this pile dwelling could be an architecture that comes with the people and gets reproduced because of resources available, but with time, with deforestation, probably resources diminish, and then changes show that these people are able to adapt and change. The site here is the plan of the site, has been excavated since the 19th century. And as you can see here from the different colors, it was excavated in many different ways, and mostly it was just shoveled away, because this is what happened in the plain. They were small tells, basically, these Bronze Age sites on a very flat landscape. And in the 19th century, this was a very rich soil, and the owner of the fields around just took them and spread to fertilize their fields. But of course, there was a lot of finds, and this got collected by the museum, so there is an immense amount of finds that have no context, but we work with them as well. As you can see from this other picture, this is different phases of sort of one of the houses of the site, and so you can see that they get rebuilt on top of each other. It's very tightly inhabited, this settlement, and it looked like that there is an organization, like lots, where you get to rebuild, but you cannot expand much more. So it's a sort of urban situation almost. And as I said, there is a lot of textile tools from this place. This is about the Terramara phenomenon. This is a map that shows the evolution of the phenomenon. So you can see it increased dramatically. You have a first here colonization, and then the settlement just multiplicates. And at the between Middle Bronze Age 3 and recent Bronze Age 1, you see also they become square, they become larger. You have a sort of hierarchization probably between different sites. And the population increased dramatically. You can see from these graphs, this phenomenon starts with very few the station on the plain, and it becomes this is the number of known settlements, and this is the hectares that are occupied, and the population estimates, of course, with all the bias error, could be a population at the end of the phenomenon of 150,000 people. So it's a lot of people, and you can understand that there is needs of textile production at the industrial scale. This is a reconstruction of the site. Montale, differently from other places, doesn't increase in size. It remains this hectare. So it's a relatively small village in this context, but it's a very rich one. And one of the reasons for this stability problem maybe is connected to this textile production that makes it different from other sites of the plain. There is textile production everywhere, but not at the scale that you can see in Montale. One of the reasons I believe that the production is connected to its wool production mainly, that is done at Montale, and you can see here from this picture, it lies in a very specific strategic geographical position, because it's on the plain, and the plain is really flat, it's a plain. But it's very close to the Apennine mountain that starts a few kilometers afterwards. And the landscape is really like this. The plain stops and the mountain starts. And that I think gives an advantage, because you have the possibility to use, for example, for your sheep, I believe this is the case, of summer pasture, so you can free land, for example, for agriculture, or you can bring forage that you harvest in the mountain down to the plain, which probably I would suggest now it's the case, because I think the sheep didn't move that much. But I don't know if we have time to discuss that. This is not moving. What's really striking about Montale is the spindle whorls. As you can see in this line, this is the collection that were done during the 19th century by the museum. And the spindle whorls are this line, and you see that there is quite a striking difference. There is spindle whorls everywhere, but in Montale there is about 4,500 spindle whorls that have been collected. And even other sites where there were a lot of them, like 400, the difference is just, I don't need to say much. And during the modern excavation that were done at the beginning of 2001, they found 182 spindle whorls, but the excavation was on 45 square meters. So making comparisons, it really matched the numbers that from the 19th century collection. And actually, in the end, you could say that probably there were much more, because of course all the fragmentary spindle whorls were not collected. So it is. Everybody was basically spinning all the time, I would say, but this is another thing. You can see, however, because this from the modern excavation gives you the possibility to see that there is changes with time. Of course, the 45 square meters is too little, and there could be more concentration in other areas. But it's interesting because you see that in the first phases you have more spindle whorls, and then they tend to diminish. And at the end of the recent Bronze Age, there is basically no traces. It could be that the last levels are very disturbed, there were no clear structures and so on and so forth. But at the same time, this is weak. But it could also be, and I think that's the case, a change in politics of production, the political economical changes. Because as we said, and I don't go. You need, in order to produce textile, there is a very large need for wool, and beside all the things that Christian said about the quality and how you organize your sheepherding, you need quantities. And with the Bronze Age animals, you would not be able to get large quantities from one animal. You need the possibility to organize enormous sheepherding around the site. And you can see this is the faunal remains. From the faunal remains through the phases, the number of sheep keeps increasing. So although the spindle whorls decrease, I think this is a sign that you have wool production, and that you change the kind of product that you are interested in, that you try to produce. And I think also that this discrepancy between the spindle whorls and the sheep is in itself supports the idea that it's wool, because wool is this fiber that you can actually sell even before you spin. Once you have collected and cleaned it, it's actually a very valuable good in itself. While, for example, flax, until you have a spun yarn, you cannot really do much with it. I think you wouldn't have row of flax traveling around before the spin. So, and the evidence in the pollen analysis that have been done on the plain, this is different size, and this is Montale, and as a proxy for sheepherding, they have been used this, I cannot pronounce it, chicoria pollen. As evidence of intense pastoral activity. As you can see here, you would say that at the different sites there is actually a different emphasis on pastoral activity, and on Montale it is quite stable and quite high. So it would, and I think it's much the evidence mean that you have a lot of sheep herding around the site. And I think this is very interesting, because since each sheep would provide very little wool, it's actually a very, very valuable animal. It's not someone that you would let go in the mountain, but you keep them around in the plain. And maybe, as I said, it's the food that comes from the mountain down to the plain, at least during the Bronze Age, because sheep have a very, very quick evolution, I think. At the end of the Iron Age, they become different, and you start having shears and other new tools that are not existing during the Bronze Age. So probably the wool becomes more and large. Thinking about Montale and the situation and so on and so forth, I've been trying to do some calculations, and this is for I just show you the Middle Bronze Age too, so the first phase, and you still have also a lot of spindle work. And they did, the area is very well studied, they did Thyssen polygons, tried to apply Thyssen polygons in the province, and with known, of course, again, with all the problems that this model has, it would turn out that Montale managed a very, very large territory, so around 2,200 hectares that have Montale as the main site. And if you consider that 1 hectare, they say a population of 120, 130 people maximum on site, with this large territory around, even if there is about 30% from the pollen diagrams that is a forested area, and you would say at least 20% for agriculture, which is still quite a lot, it's over 400 hectares for a small population, it's quite an intense agriculture, you have around over 1,000 hectares for your animals, and the sheep won't be dominating. So if you have, I tried different stocking rates in the plain, if you have only 2 sheep per hectare, which is very, very low, it really gives you a possibility of a lot of other things going on, you already have something like 3,000 animals. So between 3,000 and 6,000 animals, and you still are quite humble with your predictions, and which give, as you can see in the end, something like a wool production of clean wool, which could be between 0.5 ton and almost 1.5 ton. It's not enormous if you think in Mediterranean Aegean terms, there you would have a lot more, but still it's a production this way beyond what a small community would need. So it is, I think, it supports the idea that this site invests heavily in wool production, and that this wool production is not only the main, but it's a developing production. It changes. I think it goes from spinning threads to producing raw wool. And one thing that I think it supports this idea that it's a very dynamic production and political economy is, again, the pollen diagrams. As you can see, well, it's not particularly clear, but we don't have time, but you see that there is some changing, and in particular this, during the first phases, you have these cherry trees that are dominating with the fruit, and from the phase 8, you have the introduction of wine, of grape, which basically takes over, and it would seem, and this is correspond to the drop in spindle wool. So I think that this is a very active community that produce textile and wool, but it also produce other things. And when the other things become important, then drops part of the textile work, because it is very time demanding, the spinning process, for example. As you can see in the previous one, it's very, very many hours. If you see the last part, if you have 1,300 kilos of clean wool, you would have 122 people working full time for a year, which is about the whole community. I finish here. I think that through the study of the archaeological material, we can get very close to what textile production could mean to different communities. So far, there's not that many studies in Europe, but I think we have to look for similar case studies, because I think wool production was something that emerged in Bronze Age and was taken on by single communities that understood the importance of it. So not everybody would do that. Thank you.